Every year, we ask people to fill out evaluation forms, and this really helps us know how to proceed for the next year's program. And one of the comments that came on last year's evaluations was, please talk about how to use your lesson. And I thought that that was a great suggestion, so I wanted to spend just a few moments today talking about how to use a lesson. Because I've realized for some time now that people do sometimes have trouble understanding what a lesson is all about. I traveled a lot to teach, and this was brought home to me once when I was in another location teaching. You know, I greet the student when she comes in the door, everything is set up on the music rack, and then she turns to me with a benign smile and says, "What should I do?" So it takes a lot to render me speechless, but I'll tell you, I did not know what to say. You know, other comments that you hear maybe as a teacher would be, "Do you want me to play it with both hands?" Or, "Should I play it with pedal?" Or, "I didn't practice this yet, but should I play it anyway?" I realize that some people actually have no idea how to take a lesson, what to do to prepare for one, what to do during the lesson, and then what to do after the lesson. So I want to make some comments about lessons in general, but first I'd like to address a couple of questions. First of all, what is a Taubman lesson? And second, how is it different from a traditional lesson? I'd like to say some things about every kind of lesson so that people who are taking Taubman lessons have some clear ideas about how to proceed, and then people just taking lessons in general maybe have some ideas about how to proceed with their own lessons. You know, I think lessons are very often traditionally thought of as mini performances. You go in, you play for the teacher the whole piece through, the teacher makes a comment, you come back the next week, you do another mini performance, the teacher makes another comment. I can remember very clearly from my school days that I had friends who would say, well, I wouldn't think of taking a piece to my teacher without having it memorized first. So, you know, the piece had to be memorized, it had to be internalized, it had to be ready for performance, then you were good to go. But for Mrs. Taubman, lessons were always collaborative. You know, one of the first things she would ask after you walked into the studio is, how's your work going? There's some kind of implicit understanding that the student was working toward a goal, and she was guiding the student along the pathway toward that goal. When a student seemed lost in a lesson one day to me, it occurred to me that taking a lesson is a skill. It's actually a skill. And like other skills at the keyboard, it can be learned if someone doesn't really know how to do it. So here's how I view a lesson. I think of it as a snapshot. What are the hands doing today? What are they doing right now? Then how can we push those hands towards better performance? How can they internalize the skills better? How can we make the situation smoother, easier, make it approach normalcy? So it's always about the process of making things better for me. The lesson should always be a collaboration. The student needs my input, and I need the student's feedback while we're working together in order to know how to push the process forward. We know we can't separate the physical from the musical in the end. And one of the enormous benefits of the Taubman work is that it's about the craft of piano playing. That means we have an enormous repository of tools to use when we have problems. It's very much a how-to approach. Now, contrast this with other approaches, and you'll see what I mean. I was in Europe a number of years ago participating in master classes with a well-known pianist, and at one point, you know, he said to the pianist, "It's a celestial piece, you should be looking at the sky." So, you know, she turns her gaze upward, and it sounds like it would be funny, but she was in tears, and, you know, she had cast her gaze heavenward in such a way that she dislodged a contact lens. Everything came to a grinding standstill, and the professor was very unhappy, and I thought to myself, this is just not teaching. This is not what teaching is all about. So the question is how to derive benefit from a lesson. As a student, you have to learn to think logically. And that's one of the huge benefits of doing this work. There are identifiable reasons why we have problems. Now, as a student, you don't know what all those reasons are, but you're trusting the teacher to help you identify problems when you run up against them. It's not just that you practice, 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 then hope for the best. No, what we try to do is look, see, find out where the problems are, and then solve them. So one of the things that you can do as a student, and I include this because I'm also a student, is to look at your hands, see what they're actually doing, see where it looks like things are awkward. It's very simple. Just use the powers of your own observation. Then listen to the sounds you're making. What's coming out of the piano? Is it the result you want? Is it easy to do? Does it feel random or does it feel intentional? Then feel the physical sensations you're having. You know, sometimes I'm amazed because I kind of forget what it was like in the old days before I was aware of the feelings of my body, but someone will play something, we'll make an adjustment, I'll ask them how it feels. Oh, it feels the same. And I'm thinking to myself, it can't possibly feel the same. There was a different fingering, there was a different shape, there was something different, it can't feel the same. And yet sometimes people are so not tuned into their bodies that they don't understand how to feel difference. Now, when things get better and better, you begin to feel minute differences in the playing, and that's important. But it's also very important to train yourself as a student to feel a difference. If a teacher asks you if something feels different, it may not feel very different, but there may be some significant difference that you can report that will help push the process along. Then evaluate the results. Are you getting the desired result? Can you do it over and over again? Or does it seem like an accident when it finally comes? Also, as students, we need to learn how to see our teachers as resources. Presumably, you've sought out a teacher because you think he or she can share helpful information with you. You need to always engage the teacher in the lesson, in dialogue. And I would say don't be afraid to challenge what the teacher says. People who study with me know that I constantly encourage this. A teacher should be able to defend any position. And far from being disrespectful, it's a way to help the teacher understand what the student is thinking and therefore help the student understand how to move forward. The most efficient use of your lesson time comes when you're very specific with your teacher about problem areas. Come to the lesson with questions, very precise questions, about the things that are bothering you. I remember once early on when I was studying with Mrs. Taubman, we were working and I said, I hate this page. And she said, you don't hate that page, you hate two notes in that page. Now you show me where those two notes are. She could teach a very good lesson with very few words sometimes. But I realized that there is a specific place where things start to derail when you have a problem. Now there might be a lot of two-note combinations on a particular page where you're having problems, but the problem starts here, going to here. That's where the problem is. And as a student, if you can identify where the problem area is, that's excellent. It's also good to grapple with solutions. And you know, it's interesting also to think about how Mrs. Taubman would react to the solutions. You would go in and say, you know, I have a problem here. I think maybe it's a shaping that doesn't do this or doesn't do this and should do that. And she said, look, if you'd already solved the problem, it wouldn't be a problem anymore. So let's see what's really going on here. It's fine to take a look and see what you're doing, but you're relying on the teacher's advice when you zero right into a problem to tell you, okay, let's take a look at this. You know, it's always wonderful when you think the problem is either this or this, and the teacher says, oh no, the problem's over here, the problem is this, because you get to learn a whole new situation. Now, sometimes, you know, I encourage this, of course, in my students, and somebody will come in and say, I had a problem on this page, and I know it's someplace on this page. It was someplace on this page, but I don't know where it is. And I'm thinking, well, that just doesn't help push the lesson forward, all right? First of all, we don't know where the problem area really is, and then we don't know how to attack it, if we, to locate it first. So I would say be precise. You know, I come in with a list to Edna, you know, page 3, line 2, measure 2, third beat, something funny. And, you know, you can identify a problem area that way. Then, you know, you have maybe the other extreme where somebody comes in and says, oh, everything feels good. And thinking, all right, this is going to be an easy lesson. They start, it's breakdown after breakdown after breakdown after breakdown. They're not getting through the first page. And you think, this is someone who's not paying attention to what's happening. A problem is when you stumble, okay? It's that simple. A problem is when you stumble. Or a problem is when you don't get the result you want. Or a problem is when you feel tight. A problem is when something goes wrong. And when I say something, I mean anything. Anything that doesn't go right, that's a problem. And generally with people that are willing adults or willing kids, as I know the kids here are, It's not because you're not interested, you don't care enough, you haven't practiced enough. It's because you're missing a piece of information. And the wonderful thing about this work, why I love it so, is it's about information. It's logical. And once you have the right piece of information, things get solved. So an enormous amount can be learned by watching the teacher demonstrate. Now, this, of course, presupposes that the teacher can perform the skill that they're trying to teach. But look at a teacher's hands when they're playing. It doesn't happen too often, but sometimes I'll demonstrate something and I'll notice that the person isn't looking. And I'm thinking, I'm not doing this for your entertainment. I want you to see something. I want you to see something about what my hands are doing. It took me a while to learn also that people don't see when they look. You know, they'll look at my hands, but they won't pick up what I want them to actually see. So if you're a student and you're wondering about this kind of learning, when your teacher demonstrates, if it's a question of choreography, look at exactly how the hands are moving. The teacher will talk through a passage and say, I want you to do this here and this here. If it's a question of managing the key spot correctly, look at the relationship of the hand to the black keys. Sometimes I'll play something, my thumb will be in a particular place, which is what I want people to see. The student will demonstrate and the thumb is in a wildly different place. Nothing gets learned by that. So if you look at a teacher's hands, then you can learn a lot from this kind of thing. Be willing to repeat a passage at a lesson enough times so that it goes into the body and makes sense. When I hear somebody say, got it, after playing something once and not really getting it, I know that success is not lurking around the corner. Students often think they're doing what you ask, when they're actually not. And this just shows how powerful habits are. It doesn't have anything to do with a student not paying attention. It just shows that habits are very powerful once they get into the body. And changing habits takes some time to do. So as a student, you can't make changes precisely enough until you understand the pattern that you're trying to duplicate, because that's what has to become automatic in the body in the end. So I'm always thrilled when somebody says to me, can I try it again? Because I know the student's grappling with a problem. I know that, you know, there's an attempt to internalize the model so that it can be practiced at home. And conversely, I'm leery when somebody says, oh, that'll be fine, you know, after just observing me do something without even trying it. So don't be afraid to try things many times at your lesson. You need a very strong internal model in order to practice something well at home. Finally, Learning something new or refining a skill requires patience. It requires patience at the lesson, and it requires patience during the practicing. I have a lot of people who are very self-motivated, driven people, and they're impatient with themselves. And I can be that way with myself too, so it's not that I don't understand it. But from the teacher's side, looking on, there has to be kind of a calm mental environment in order for any kind of progress to occur. You know, we think of some people as kind of easy learners and some people as nervous learners. As teachers, it's a good thing always if you can create a mental environment where it's easy to learn. So, you know, things are complicated. We're adjusting, making micro adjustments. We're dealing with extremely small movements and combinations of movements. And for that reason, you have to be patient with yourself to internalize something that's new and difficult to do. You should feel comfortable enough with the model after the lesson so that you can be confident that when you go home and practice it, you'll be doing the right thing. Because it's pointless just to go home and bang away at something when you have no idea what you're actually looking for. And Edna talked a little bit about practicing earlier, so I won't reiterate that. But basically what you do when you practice is you take your lesson over and over again. And you don't have to do things many times, a lot of time. You have to do things right. Okay, if you do things right several times, it begins to go in the body begins to understand it and internalize it in some way and form a habit. If you do things wrong over and over again, the body internalizes that too, and you can be sure that you'll get what you practice for. So I also thought that I would say that there are a few different kinds of lessons, and you know, you may recognize yourself in some of these, and we all take different kinds of lessons at different points in our careers. First of all, if you're taking a lesson where you're seeking a complete technical solution, the work is going to be very slow, very methodical, very meticulous, and that's absolutely suitable for some people some of the time. If you're dealing with an injury, if you're reworking a technique, that's a kind of lesson you should expect to have. Then there's another kind of lesson called learning a piece. The technical aspects are working pretty well, and what you're doing is you're looking at specific passage problems and solving those, choreographing specific problems. So it's not the same kind of thing as going from finger to finger, going from note to note, checking is the balance right, is the rotation right, did everything line up right. That's a different kind of lesson altogether. And then there's a kind of lesson called, I've got to play it Tuesday. So, you know, that kind of a lesson, the teacher will take away impediments, hopefully, during the lesson. I mean, we can talk about general things like curling in certain places, twisting in certain places, stretching in certain places. You're not going to be digging deep in that kind of a lesson, and a teacher won't want to take you down deep and make fundamental changes, but simply help find a solution that makes things feel a little bit better for the performance. I would say that essentially, if you're taking this kind of lesson, what you're looking for is a way around awkwardness. What you're looking for is something that moves towards smoothness. You know, even if you don't know the right solution, as a teacher or as a student, if you can move in the direction of smoothness, you're definitely moving in the right direction. And so it's kind of not a look at a lesson through an academically correct lens, it's a look at a lesson through what can I do that will help right now lens. And that's a very important kind of lesson to take when you're getting ready for a performance or when a performance looms close. So there are certain organizational solutions that we can provide that don't have anything to do with the basic technical work. In other words, if I see somebody stretching, I can suggest a certain grouping that will break up the passage and eliminate the stretching. That already makes things feel better. I don't talk about the rotation, I don't talk about the in and out, I don't talk about anything except organizing the passage for greater ease. And there are a lot of, I don't want to say tricks because it's more than that, but there are a lot of solutions we have for things like this. You're going to hear a lecture about grouping tomorrow. It's a tremendously helpful tool that you don't have to know too much about the basic work to make use of. Things like issues like fingering. You know, if you choose a fingering that's grateful for the hand, you're already a long way towards having success with the passage. And conversely, if you choose a fingering that's not grateful for the hand, no amount of practice is going to make it feel that much better. Unfortunately, a lot of the editorially suggested fingering is not very good because it's based on certain premises that don't really apply at all to the way the body moves. Then I would say also that you can't take two different kinds of lesson at the same time. And that may seem obvious to you, but I'll give you a quick example. Somebody came recently and lots of technical issues, but a performance was coming up. So wanted to balance on each finger, and you know, I thought, okay, well, so this is what we're going to do. So, you know, working finger to finger. Then after 5 minutes, let's do the Beethoven Fifth. It's time for me to play. And I'm thinking, what we just did has no relationship to the Beethoven Fifth. I mean, it may in 2 months or 2 years, but not right now. So it was a complete waste of time as far as I was concerned. It didn't have anything to do with the problem at hand. So I hope that gives you a little bit of an idea about how to use your lesson time in a more effective way. If you're a teacher, you can encourage students in this way. And if you're a student, then you can make use of your teacher by providing very concrete feedback, by being very attentive to the exact problems that you have, by practicing precisely what those solutions are, by not jumping the gun and doing something different from what the teacher suggested. Anybody have any questions?
If you have a student come and you say, what would you like to work on? And they're at the point they should know, and they say they don't have any list. Should you wait until they come up and produce a spot that they have found is troublesome? If a relatively small length of time, or do you just say, well, let's start here? You know, let's.
So if the student comes to a lesson without an idea of what to do, should you force the student to actually come up with a plan of action, or should you implement a plan of action? I think, you know, students have to be educated, so I would jump in and I would say, let's do this now. Whatever repertoire they're working on, you'll be able to find issues. And particularly if you tune students in, if you're teachers, if you tune students in to listening to what they do, ask them, when they play something that doesn't satisfy your ears, say, were you happy with that? Did that go the way you wanted it to go? Are you getting the result you want? That's a great question. Are you getting the result you want? because it engages the student immediately in the process of playing. It's not just random anymore.